young Mark. Let's go. Get in here. A lot to learn today. Today, we're going to look at the history, the rise and fall of my alma mater. What happens when a mid-major attempts to climb the athletic ladder of the NCAA? What lessons can be learned from that experience? Today, we're finding Fresno. Let's go rogue. I had prepared to do this video for quite some time and then took my videos in a different direction. I was reminded by a viewer. Can I say that? I mean, that just sounds so... a viewer. I was reminded by somebody that saw one of my videos that Tulsa was in the actual 16-team Western Athletic Mega Conference back in the 90s, and it was not Houston. My bad. I was then reminded after reading this guy's comment that it was Tulsa that started Fresno State on its decline after its great start in 2001 and keeping them from being the first BCS buster. I think there's some lessons to be learned from that Fresno experience. History. The California State University Fresno has historically been a good mid-major school athletically. They won a number of conference championships, first as members of the Pacific Coast Athletic Association, then the Big West. They were 1982 National Invitation Tournament basketball champions, and they beat Patrick Ewing and Georgetown the next year on a tournament in Hawaii. They were constantly competitive against Jerry Tarkanian's University of Nevada, Las Vegas Runnin' Rebels in the 1980s. In 1991, Fresno made the jump to the Western Athletic Conference, the original WAC, with Utah and BYU and San Diego State. The year before, my wife and I sat in Bulldog Stadium watching my Bulldogs put 94 points on the University of New Mexico. Their second season in the Western Athletic Conference, the Bulldogs shared the conference championship and then beat USC in the 1992 Freedom Bowl. Fresno State won a softball national championship in 1998 and won the College World Series in 2008. I grew up in the Central Valley and I was a fan of Fresno State growing up in the 70s and 80s. I got my first history degree from the California State University at Fresno. I even tried out to be the Bulldog. Didn't win the job, but still, with that big mascot on my head, it was awesome. In 1985, the Fresno State football team ended the season as the nation's only undefeated team, but only ranked 16 in the polls. Their best win was at home against Oregon State, and their record was only blemished by a tie against Hawaii. In the coaches' poll, Barry Switzer voted Fresno State national champions. It was Barry Switzer's one-loss Oklahoma team that itself was voted national champion. Suddenly, people in Fresno thought they're going to be getting an invitation to the Pac-10. Well, there were some things working against Fresno State in its efforts to be invited to the Pac-10. Let's look through the lens of history and find out 6 reasons why it's hard for a mid-major to make the jump to a Power 5 conference. Let's find Fresno. History lesson number 1. If you schedule a bunch of teams that are only a few years away from dropping their football program, you probably shouldn't be considered for a national championship or a major conference. Nor should you. Fresno's 1985 schedule had Fullerton, Long Beach State, Pacific, and Wichita State, who all dropped their football programs in the next couple of years. Then along came Pat Hill. Hill changed Fresno State's scheduling philosophy. His dogs would play anyone, anytime, anywhere. And his teams did, and did, and did. In 2005, the dogs lost to the Reggie Bush-led USC Trojans in a game at LA Memorial Stadium. In a 50-42 barn burner, people remember Reggie Bush running for like 800 yards. But they forget that Fresno was driving down by 8 points and lost at the last second when they threw an interception in the end zone. Anyone, anytime, anywhere. The big year for Pat Hill and Fresno State was 2001. It looked like Fresno would be the first mid-major to bust the BCS, with big wins in consecutive weeks at eventual Big 12 champion Colorado, at home against number 10 Oregon State, and at Camp Randall Stadium against number 23 Wisconsin. After 3 more conference wins, the Dogs rose in the polls to number 8. Then they took it on the chin at home against Boise State, ending their hopes for a BCS Bowl, and putting Boise State on a trajectory to become the next mid-major darling. This is lesson number two. If you put your kids in a place where they're going to get pounded week after week after week by much bigger players, even if you do run the gauntlet, the beatings are going to catch up to you. As I watched the Dogs in the weeks following their big wins at Wisconsin and Colorado and Oregon State, I noticed the margin of victory. They beat Tulsa by 19. They beat Louisiana Tech by 10. Beat Colorado by 3. The beatings caught up to them. They then lost to Boise the next week. And Fresno finished the season 11-3. History lesson number 3. How did Fresno get those marquee matchups against Wisconsin, Colorado, USC, later games against Tennessee and Oklahoma and Alabama? Why did those Power Conference teams agree to play Fresno, knowing that there was a chance, no matter how slight, that Fresno could beat them? Pat Hill's scheduling tactic was to forego the home-and-home contracts, where you play one game there, one game here, and then to play two-for-ones, allowing the power schools that they played two games at their place while having one return visit to Bulldog Stadium in Fresno. This did get Fresno notice on the national stage. But it left fans in Fresno and the home gate pretty empty when the Bulldogs only had 5 home games and 7 away games in 2004, 2008, and 2009. Sure, Wisconsin coming to Bulldog Stadium sold out, but New Mexico State or Cal Poly, they just weren't the same draw. The Bulldogs football program started a decline in 2006 when the Dogs went 4-8. In Hill's final 6 years as head coach, Fresno was mired in mediocrity, going 39-29 and losing most of those big games that Hill was previously known for winning. Pay attention to those home fans. Careful with the two-for-ones. You can't make money playing only 5 home games, and people don't show up at the stadium when there is no game. History lesson number 4. If your women's basketball coach is, like, really good looking, I mean, like, hot, like, burning up hot, I mean, like, burning up on re-entry hot. Keep your horndog athletic director far away from her. It was a multi-million dollar lawsuit against the school's athletic department that compounded the money issues for Fresno and steepening the curve back towards mid-major mediocrity for the Bulldogs. History lesson number 5. Find a way to hold on to your assistants, particularly your coordinators. For a school to hold on to a head coach is pretty easy. Just keep throwing money at them. They can make life very comfortable for a head coach. But the more money that you throw at a head coach, that's less money that you have for your assistants. What the Group of 5 schools have trouble doing, they have trouble holding on to assistants, particularly a good coordinator. See, a coordinator at a mid-major school can easily be poached by either a school at a larger conference for the same job, or they can be given the job as head coach at a smaller school. Since 2000, Fresno's gone through 10 offensive coordinators and 8 defensive coordinators. And for 3 years, Pat Hill had to fill the job of offensive coordinator on his own. This lack of consistency makes building a good program very difficult. I got class in 10 minutes. History lesson number 6. Keep in mind that the mid-majors, particularly good ones, are the bane of the existence of the Power 5. Every time a Group of 5 school beats a Power 5 school, it's an embarrassment. It's remembered longer than any awesome victory that a Power 5 school may have had otherwise. In spite of all the national championships that Oklahoma has won, what do people remember? That Fiesta Bowl loss to Boise State. Sure, Michigan fan can tell us all about their 1973 national championship. I just made that up. I don't know if they won it in 73 or not. They won somewhere around there. But casual fan only remembers the home loss to Appalachian State in the Big House. The 1992 Freedom Bowl cost Larry Smith his job at USC. The ACC has been embarrassed so many times by the mid-majors that they now limit how many mid-majors each school can schedule each year. More and more, the Power 5 conferences are freezing out the Group of 5. So who's your school? Power 5 or Group of 5? Do you see it how I do? Is the Power Five trying to freeze out the members of the Group of Five conferences? Is your school one of those trying to climb the NCAA athletic ladder? UCF, Memphis, Cincinnati, Boise? Do you see some of the problems that Fresno State ran into in its climb? Let me know in the comments below. If you enjoy college football, particularly the history of college football, I would be honored if you would subscribe to my channel. I don't just do college sports. I talk history through movies, TV, music as well. I do my best to keep you entertained while you are quarantined. So remember, next time you see a Group of Five school putting a beat down on a Power Five school, remember me. I'm Mark Hacker. I'm a history teacher. And I've gone right.